that's way more than I needed to describe anything. Okay, so what the heck am I doing? You sound like, you know, like you're playing a bunch of nonsense. Well, okay, so this is a practice session. I'm not trying to imitate Joe Satriani's The Crush of Love from Dreaming Number 11. This is like one of his first albums, if not his, probably his third, actually. But this is the only one that actually sold. So what I was doing with this song was using the technique of knowing the scale up and down the fretboard, and then I would see if I could just use those notes. And what I do is I use all of the notes in the scale, and a lot of times I try to limit myself to just the pentatonic notes. Okay, so if you don't know what that means, once you learn all of the notes in a particular key, to move it, so stage two, after 15 years of practicing, is being able to move it. So I have the pattern here, all the way up and down, and then I move it up, and then and it goes all the way up and down the fret, or I jump it to here. Okay, so my battery's about to die, so I'll just run this video out. So this is an informative video for lead guitarists who want to chat about stuff. And so what we're talking about is being able to move.
Hey, how's it going?
We're talking about moving the pattern. Like, let's say if you know the key of G in the Phrygian mode, normally how we do this is as we do it like that. Now, usually don't isolate like that and call this a Phrygian mode. This is the difference between the way I play and the way a lot of people have learned how to play. What I do is I mix all of it together so it makes sense as a unit. And before I did that, I could not play in this way. So I let a song play. Now, after about 3 weeks of practicing it like that, I can let a song play and just jump right into it. And I can move the pattern around and go, okay, well, this let's see, it's those particular notes. I know immediately that I do it by the numbers, that this is the 7, the 1, the 2, the 3, the 4, the 5, and then the 6, 7, and the 1. Right, and those repeated here. So you jump those all around, and what you find is a lot of songs, they don't like to play all of the notes all of the time. Like, you can't just play any note in the scale. What you have to do is kind of pick your battles, and you usually don't play the 4th and the 6th, because those are the, if you remove those, 4th and the 7th, you get the pentatonic scale. So what we try to do is you memorize the major scale pattern up and down, and then you subtract it to make it the pentatonics by subtracting those two notes. So you get 7 for the major and 5 for the pentatonic. So you have to know what those two notes are that you're subtracting. And that's the 4th and the 7th, right? So let's look at the Aeolian here. And I'm going to get a little closer to the camera here. So a lot of people know this from the 12th fret in the key of G. Most people start in the key of G. We have just the Aeolian mode all by itself. Thank you. Now, I know it might be difficult for you to see every position I have, because I have huge fingers compared to most guitarists. And that was a pretty much a disadvantage for me most of the time. But it's actually helped me because I have to play correctly, as opposed to a lot of people who have small fingers. They can get away with all kinds of nonsense. So, by taking away certain notes, that yucky note right there, we get this. So this is a new series I have on the phone guitar phone number. If you remember, this would be a 3, so it's a 1-3-4. Then I have another 1-3-4, which we're gonna delete that. So here's the 7th right here, because if you know these four notes right in a row here are always this little box here. That's what I call it. Is always going to be the bottom one is going to be the 7th. Here's your root note. Here is your 3rd and your 4th. 7, 1, 3, 4. And if you can get to counting that way. So all I'm going to do is delete the 7 right here. And then I'm going to delete the 4th here. So these diagonal notes right there. 7 and 4. Now if you know what they are, scream it out. F sharp. And so we have, remember my older series, we have this the note G. So what comes after Father Charles goes right down, right? So goes down, is this a D? No, it goes backwards. It's Charles goes, and then the D would be above the G. So this is a C. So I have E, G, and then I have A, C. So I've subtracted the F sharp and the C. And now we have the pentatonic scale. You have to do that for every note, of course, or every string, I'm sorry. But what you do is you figure out, okay, well, when I'm playing this scale, I get to this part, if I play this note, some chords that could be found in that key of G or key of G or E minor song, E minor being the relative same thing, the mirror end of it basically. So let's talk about that real quick, because there is an argument among people that know me. That's not right, you're not doing it right. Sorry, I use that voice. They don't talk like that. But because they come from a traditional soloing background, they learned that the key of E minor is a relative minor to the key of G. And I just say, why not just call it the key of G?
Well, you don't understand music. Music has
to... No, it doesn't. I mean, to the understanding in your brain, it doesn't. So what I do is I say, that's a bunch of nonsense. I throw it away. Because I've already... It's like Bruce Lee said, okay... I teach you a punch with your right hand. Silam Dao, right? The form in Wing Chun. If I teach it to you in your right hand, you should have learned it in your left instinctively. You shouldn't have to, I have to learn it here. So if I learn it as white, you should already see it as black, right? Most people, their brain doesn't work that way. Mine just... most people's actually works by seeing the mirror end of things. But other people, they have to see this whole string of nonsense before they go, yeah. And I hate that. I want the simplest, tiniest, easiest deliverable method. So, and it's because of my background as a martial artist, I can't sit here and think, I have to block and then hit. No, I have to hit and block at the same time, and I want to condense it into an object rather than a technique. So this isn't a block, this isn't a note, it's a more grand concept. Okay, so get back off of the horse. And when I play these solos, okay, we could edit that, but no, I'm just going to leave it in. So I play the solos, I just play the practice, not solos. I'm practicing over this key signature, which he was playing in the key of G, and he dipped into certain keys, and I've already talked about that, and I don't have time to just go off on everything here. But you tend to listen, and you say selectively, I know when I can play those tense notes, the fourth and the seventh, and I'm going to do it here. A lot of times on the pentatonics, you can go, well, I can play these pentatonics anywhere, unless a song dips into a minor note for a brief moment, like a flat 13 and in some songs. I was playing a classical piece. I play everything. I was playing a classical piece by Barry Manilow, and I had to realize, Barry Manilow, sorry, that certain songs move in certain ways. And this is kind of what I wanted to talk to you about. So the very end of the video, I give you the meat and potatoes. Okay, so here I have the key of G. And once you really get to know this, so I'm talking about guitarists who've played and they know the fretboard, right? And hopefully they've already made this connection and they're like, yeah, I've already heard this. So what I want to say is on the bottom, using my phone number series, in the key of G in Aeolian, it's a 1, 2, 4, or 2, and then a 3. That's right, 2, 3. And in the key of C, a lot of times people jump fifths. So they go G, C, and they'll go, the C is a 2, 2. So 2 and a 3, you know, very close. So we're only talking about this one little note here to change it to, you know, you switch these two fingers. And now you're in the key of C. So a lot of times you'll find a song that goes from the key of G, and then when it does the chord change, it goes to the key of C. Sorry, did I say G to C? C to G, whatever. Another variation that people do is instead of going from the fifth jumps, is they'll just move it up a whole step. And that's just a standard progression of da 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 da. Da 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 da. So it just kind of builds on it. And Barry Manilow likes to do it where he goes the whole step jump. So you move your pattern one whole step, basically. It moves up a whole key. So from G to A, and it skips G sharp or A flat. So then he'll go from G to A, and then from A to B, and then maybe from B to C or something like that. So those are the two major relationships, jumping the fifth and jumping the two. So if you're sitting here, you're playing, you know the thing, and all of a sudden you hear, oh, that's a chord change. A lot of times you're going to get really good at going, okay, that's a whole step chord change, or that's a fifth jump. And once in a while, you get these guys that just want to bend the standard ear rule. Not that there's a rule, but it's just kind of an ear rule. And they'll want to go, oh, I want to go from C to F sharp. Because that makes sense. And, you know, in some songs, in their genre of music, it's going to make perfect sense. When you hear it, you're going to be like, yeah, it has to go from mud to muddier, or else my song is not, it turns into a country song if I don't do that. So hopefully you understand that, you get the idea of what I'm talking about. Try to practice this way if you get a chance. Just plug in a song, start playing, try to find the key as soon as it starts playing. You know, give yourself, at first, say, you know, you're starting out. Once you memorize the thing, start out, you should get it from, you know, within 20 seconds. And then try to get it within 10 seconds. And then try to get it within 5 seconds. And then try to get it within 3 notes. You know, you're playing, you know, the song goes and you go, and bam, you know the key signature. And that's kind of where I'm at right now. Is I'll play, a lot of times I'll play 2 to 3 notes and I'll go, aha. So in order to do that, you have to choose the notes perfectly. So let's say the song's going and I choose to play these 2 notes here that are a whole step apart. Now that may be a good idea, but sometimes that might be a terrible idea. So what I want to do maybe is go 1 note. This is what I'm working up to now. So I'll play 1 note and maybe I'll play it muted. And then I'll go, does that note fit? And I'll say, huh, yeah, it does. So then my odds are 50-50, right? If I just guess that one of these next 2 notes up here will work. Well, then I just minimize the odds and do it in my head. I play this note, and then I go, da, da. Right, I play the note above it, da. And then if I say, so it's in my head, no, that doesn't work in this song, so I go, right? And then immediately, this is the hardest part. I'm going to try to see if that's the 3rd and 4th, and this is the 7th and the root. So immediately I know this note fits. So I go. So then I can play that. And then I go. Nah, nah. Yeah, that works. So then I say, okay. Immediately I have 1, and I have to say, what key is that instantaneously? So, can you do it? I'll give you a few seconds. This is the key of, right? Here we have the 7th and the root. Don't worry about what note that is. Right here we have... So just get right into the pattern. Don't even stop to think, what key is that? There's the key signature, right? If you're on the root, right? E flat, unless you're drop tuning. And my son likes to drop tune things. He's like, no, it's in C, drop C sharp or whatever. I'm like, but I can play this guitar in regular tuning because, you know, drop keys are for people that want to get that deep bass note. That should be it. It shouldn't be for, now I have to learn a whole new way to solo. Yuck. Okay. Hopefully too much information. See you guys on the flip side.